بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
الحمد لله وكفى، والصلاة والسلام على عبده المصطفى وآله وأصحابه المستكملين الشرفاء، أما بعد، السلام عليكم. Brothers and sisters, today we continue and have the honor of continuing the lessons regarding the Islamic Aqidah generally and the Ahlul Bayt, the family of the Prophet alayhi salam, and the Sahaba in particular, in terms of what we believe regarding them. And it's a great honor for me to talk about those great people so that we all can inshallah benefit from them, so that they don't pass us by as stories that have no meaning, but rather we should try and benefit from them so that we can apply that in our daily lives. And the Prophet ﷺ said, Al-Mujahidu, the real Mujahid, Man Jahada نفسه أو في رواية هواه, who does jihad against his nafs, his soul, and in another narration against his desires, في طاعة الله, to obey Allah. And that is the jihad that is obligatory upon every Muslim. That is the jihad that is obligatory upon every Muslim. So when we hear stories about the Sahaba رضي الله عنهم, or stories about the family of the Prophet ﷺ who have believed in Allah and did good things, who are also of course from the Sahaba who lived in his time, we must try and implement it in our lives, because sometimes our nafs, our soul may be against it, or some desires that we may have may be against it, but a sign of us doing jihad against our souls, which is very difficult, is that if our self says something that contradicts the religion of Islam and Allah tells something else, we choose that which Allah said. And that is a sign of a true mujahid, a person who does jihad against his desires and against shaitan. These are obligatory jihads that every Muslim must do before jihad with tongue, jihad with heart and everything else, and even jihad with hand, because that is part of Islam. We do not deny that, but it has conditions. So the reason I mentioned that is because when we hear the stories of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, we must reflect on them. And we must think of the ways to implement that in our lives so that we can follow them. Even if we can't become exactly like them, at least we can go close to that. So that small introduction I wanted to say before we go to the main topic. And I want to start firstly by saying and by defining, as we always do, who a Sahabi is, or Sahib in the language, in Arabic, and that's what we always do, and that's how the ulama teach us. They go to the language first of all, and in Arabic, Sahib or Sahabi means someone who accompanies you. It can mean someone who accompanied you for a little while or for a long time, that he has become a friend and companion. For that reason, when the ulama differ regarding, because the scholars of Islam, especially the scholars of hadith, because we need to know the chains of narration, the ulama of scholars of hadith, they analyze the chains of narration of hadith. So if you have a text that the Prophet ﷺ said something, they look at the person who heard it from the Prophet ﷺ. then from the person who heard it from that person, then from the, and so on and so forth until it reaches the person who recorded it in a book, like Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, or Imam Muslim, or Imam Abu Dawood al-Sijistani, or Imam al-Tirmidhi, and so on rahimahumullah, or Imam Ahmad in his Musnad. So that is very important, because to know who a Sahabi is, who a companion is very important, because if we know who a companion is, then we can look at what people said about them. Did they meet the Prophet ﷺ or not? If they did they hear any hadith from the Prophet ﷺ or not? Look how detailed the knowledge of hadith is in Islam. And this, the knowledge of the chain of narration is only for Islam. Allah favored the nation of Islam, meaning the Ummah of Islam, not those misguided people who call themselves nation of Islam. May Allah guide them. But I mean the nation of Islam as a translation of Ummatul Islam. Allah has favored them with this chain, that the Christians, they can't trace the statements of Isa, of Jesus, to him. The Jews, they can't trace statements of Musa to him, alayhi salam. But we, alhamdulillah, we can trace and we can see through the help of Allah, first of all, then the help of the scholars of hadith who specialize day and night, they study hadith. They can tell us, did the Prophet say this or not? That's amazing. And some ulama of hadith used to say, what we, when we answer hadith, for the awam, for the general public, it's like sorcery. They think that we have some special access, but it comes from learning hadith. All of that I'm saying to show the importance of knowing who a sahabi is. And of course for us, there are books that the ulama compiled regarding sahaba. I can remember three. One of them is by Imam Ibn Abd al-Barr, rahimahullah, from the, we call Al-Maghrib al-Arabi, from Andalus and those areas, the west of the Muslim countries. And he compiled a book, Al-Isti'ab fi Ma'rifat al-Ashab. And generally, just for you as a tip, the first word in most titles is not important. It's just for rhyming, for saj'ah. The second is important. So you look, Ma'rifat al-Ashab, to know the Sahaba. Also, Usdul Ghaba, by, fi Ma'rifat al-Sahaba, by Al-Jazari, Ibn al-Athir, rahimahullah, as far as I remember. And also Al-Isaba, by Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, fi Ma'rifat al-Sahaba. And there are other books, but those three I can remember now. And the most recent of them is by Ibn Hajar. So this to show that the people, the ulama, they paid special attention. And there are, of course, general books of biographies, like Al-Dhahabi Sir A'lam al-Nubala, where he lists the biographies of the Sahaba by year, for example, year such, such and such, and so on. And other books of biographies. So the ulama of Islam, they concerned themselves first of all with the Prophet ﷺ. That's the most important personality in our religion. Then they concerned themselves and they paid attention to the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, and to the Sahb. Sahb is the plural of Sahib. And in Urdu, I think, or in Punjabi, maybe both, you have something, as far as I know, Sahb, yeah? Sahb is Sahib, as far as I know. And even I was shocked, I saw it on a Sikh temple. Something, Gurdwara, something, Guru, something, Sahib. Correct or not, Ismail?
Yes,
we have expert. And the word Sahib is from the Arabic, of course. Sahib means they started using it. I think it used to be Sahib al-Fadila, maybe. The person who has virtue and this, but they dropped Fadila, as usually happens, or Sahib al-Sumu, or Sahib of something, someone who has something, and then they dropped that, and Sahib remained, because Sahib in itself doesn't show preference. Yani Sahib means a companion or a friend. So that the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they occupy special place in Islam. For that reason, we need to know who it is. The ulama of hadith, they differed, but if we go back to the definition in the language, because in Islam we have different definitions for words and understanding. One of them is lughawi, what we call ta'rif lughawi or istilah lughawi, which is in Arabic. And most things we go to Arabic. The second is shar'i, something which means something in Sharia. For example, hajj in lugha in Arabic means qasd, to aim to do something. But if you say to someone, did you do hajj? Everyone understands what you mean, because they now have become to understand hajj to mean to intend and to want to visit the Kaaba and the Sa'id, Marwa, Safa and Marwa, and the Manasik, we call those places like Muzdalifah, Mina and Arafah, and those for the purpose of offering special ibadah. The third type of definition we have, we call it urfi, haqiqa urfiya, which is something that people between themselves know. Na'am, ta'araf al-nas alayh. These are important when we talk about these issues, and this I want also to show, not to show off, but to show how deep knowledge in Islam is. And when we see our brothers and sometimes sisters, they talk very lightly of some issues, you can understand when scholars get angry, when the ulama get angry, because there are a lot of things we need to know before we talk about certain issues. For that reason, the issue of Sahaba is very easy to solve if you go back to the linguistic definition of a sahib or sahabi. And that is a person who accompanies someone even for a short period of time. For that reason, the ulama who said a sahabi is any person who saw the Prophet ﷺ and believed in him, and he died upon that belief, is considered to be a sahabi, even if that meeting was very brief. For that reason, as you can imagine, due to the number of people who used to come and see the Prophet ﷺ and believe in him and support him and learn from him, ﷺ, the number is into thousands. And you can imagine what task the scholars had to find each person's name, biography and everything, and to record it. You know, now people study medicine and every engineering 3, 5, 7 years. Okay, mashallah, some continue studying and research and research. Islamic scholars, way beyond that. Way. They start sometimes, some of them, when they're children. Or, let's say, teenagers. They memorize the Quran. Then they learn the Quran, what it means. Then hadith, then this, then that, until they have 80-something and they still researching and doing. Which, Ikhwan, tell me, which branch of any dunya knowledge does that? There is no such thing. It doesn't exist. And Allah says still, وَمَا أُوتِيتُم مِّنَ الْعِلْمِ إِلَّا قَلِيلًا. You have not been given much of knowledge after all those years. So for that reason, the great juhud or jahd, both are correct, of those ulama, the great efforts they have put and they're still putting to preserve this deen, especially in the first generations, including the Sahaba radiallahu anhu, is enormous. It's enormous. You cannot match it. But what we can try and do is to try and get close as much as we can. So a sahabi, just to repeat again, man or woman, is anyone who saw the Prophet ﷺ, meaning met, even if the person was blind, believed in him ﷺ, and died upon that. Even if they said, وَإِن تَخَلَّلَتْ رِدَّةٌ فِي الْأَسَاحِ كَمَا قَالَ ابْنُ حَجَرُ رَحْمَ اللَّهِ. Even if there is ridda, if there is very few sahaba, one or two, they became murtad, then they returned to Islam. So they still counted in the Sahaba because they died upon Islam, alhamdulillah. And the Sahaba accepted their tawbah because they saw signs that they really repented. So that is the definition of a Sahabi. Ahlul Bayt, if we look at the definition in the Lugha again, it's much easier, it's a bit easier than Sahabi or Sahib. Ahlul Bayt means anyone who resides in that house, the people of the house. That's literal meaning of Ahlul Bayt, as every Arab person who speaks Arabic knows. And when we talk, that's why we say Ahlul Bayt to mean Islamic Ahlul Bayt. Because Islamic Ahlul Bayt doesn't mean every person's house. It means the household of the Prophet ﷺ. For that reason, of course, we have a hadith which I would like to read to you. I brought it in my phone because it was very long to write. And it's in Sahih Muslim. It's in Sahih Muslim. And Zayd bin Arqam radiallahu anhu was asked by some of the Tabi'een. Zayd bin Arqam, of course, from the Sahaba. قال فلما جلسنا إليه قال له حسين أحدهم لقد لقيت يا زيد خيرا كثيرا. One of them, three of them came and one of them said, O Zayd, you have indeed seen a lot of good, خيرا كثيرا. لقد رأيت رسول الله عليه السلام وسمعت حديثه وغزوت معه وصليت خلفه. He said four things. You saw the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. That's good then. Just to see the Prophet ﷺ. And رأيت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وسمعت حديثه. And you heard his hadith. Hadith in Arabic means speech. But hadith we mean in Sharia, what the Prophet ﷺ said, did, or acknowledged, including his description, physical and other. So you heard his hadith وغزوت معه. And you fought with him. Meaning that shows that you are sincere. And you prayed behind him. لَقَدْ لَقِيْتَ يَا زَيْدُ خَيْرًا كَثِيرًا. He again said it. حَدِّثْنَا يَا زَيْدُ مَا سَمِعْتَ مِنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ. That's how they used to come to the Sahaba and say, please tell us what you heard from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. They want to hear anything. I saw, I heard, he said. Like sometimes when we in a gathering or we have food and then we talk about some amazing people, good people, oh, you know that they say, whatever. They used to come and want to hear that. So Zayd radiallahu anhu, he said, قَالَ يَبْنَ أَخِي. This also shows that the Shaykh is nice to the student. Even though the student only said, Ya Zayd. He didn't say, فَضِيلَةُ Shaykh, Allama, big Shaykh, Imam al-Thaqalain. Some people give such statements. The Imam of Jinn and Ins. You know, they exaggerate. But he came and said, Ya Zayd. Sometimes they used to come to Sahaba and say, Ya Aba Abdurrahman, by the kunya, or Ya Aba someone. He said, Ya Abna Akhi, or the son of my brother. It's a nice way in Arabic to say. نعم. And he said, والله لقد كبرت سني أو كبرت سني وقدم عهدي. I'm now old and I've lived a long life. ونسيت بعض الذي كنت أعي من رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. And I've forgotten something or some of what I used to remember from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. فما حدثتكم فاقبلوا. So what I tell you, accept from me. وَمَا لَا فَلَا تُكَلِّفُونِيهِ. So what I don't tell you, don't make me tell you. ثُمَّ قَالْ قَامَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ وَسَلَّمَ يَوْمًا فِينَ خَطِيبًا. And this a lot of Sahaba say. Once the Prophet stood up, is khatib. Doesn't have to be khutbah of Jum'ah. Khatib, he is addressing. Yeah? To address. That's why khutbah is sermon. And khitbah is what? The Arab brothers. إيش الخطبة؟ مش متزوج أنت؟ طيب المتزوجون فيانسي. طيب المتزوجون الخطبة معروفة طبعا. الخطبة is proposal for marriage. Yeah? When the person proposes. And خطبة is they, what do they share? Those two, because they have the same root. They share an address. نعم. That you addressing someone. So the Prophet ﷺ, he said, came or stood khatib. بِمَاءٍ يُدْعَى Human. There's a what you call it, a place, big place full of water that is between Mecca and Medina in some of the other narrations of this hadith, in Nasa'i and others. And many people know this, even those who deviate from the Sunnah. They call it as hadith Ghadir Khum. That Ghadir is a place full of water, that place was called Khum. بين مكة والمدينة فحمد الله وأثنى عليه ووعظ وذكر. So he praised Allah and he extolled him. And he reminded us and he gave us an admonition. ثم قال أما بعد. The Prophet used to say that, and it's also from the Arabic language to say that. أما بعد. ألا أيها الناس فإنما أنا بشر. Oh people, I am just a human being. This is to show the people who say he wasn't a normal human being and things like that. يوشك أن يأتي رسول ربي فأجيب. It is close that a messenger from my Lord will come and I will answer. That my death is close. وأنا تارك فيكم ثقلين. I leave for you two important things. أولهما كتاب الله فيه الهدى والنور فخذوا بكتاب الله واستمسكوا به. The first one is the book of Allah. So take it, in it there is guidance and nur, light. Which light? Some people say, oh, Allah said light. So the Prophet was made of light. The light meaning metaphorical, through which the person gets out of the darkness of jahl, of ignorance, and the darkness of dalal, misguidance, and the darkness of kufr and shirk, being a disbeliever, and the darkness of not knowing what who Allah is, and what his religion is, and who the Prophet ﷺ is. So the Prophet said, so take the book of Allah and hold on to it. فحث على كتاب الله ورغب فيه. So the Prophet ﷺ encouraged us a lot to hold on to the book of Allah and to learn. ثم قال وأهل بيتي. And this is what I want to point to you. That أهل بيتي means and the people of my household. أذكركم الله في أهل بيتي. أذكركم الله في أهل بيتي. أذكركم الله في أهل بيتي. He said three times. I remind you with Allah regarding the people of my household. And the ulama said the Prophet ﷺ sometimes used to repeat something three times. ليفهم منه. So the people would understand. So, and sometimes also in Bukhari, he used to say salam three times. Some ulama said because maybe they didn't hear or for some other reason. And also they described the speech of the Prophet ﷺ clear, very clear. If you wanted, they said, to count words, you could have counted them. So that is very important, especially for a person who teaches. And from whom deen is taken. So people don't say, oh, he said that. No, he said that. You know, when you listen sometimes to a bad recording, you think, oh, subhanAllah, what did he say there? No? I experience that because I sometimes hear old recordings of some ulama. So you think, like, you can't hear very well. That didn't exist with the Prophet ﷺ. Whatever he said, you could hear very easily. And he repeated it three times. فقال له حسين ومن أهل بيته. So one of those who came to learn from Zayd ibn Akham said, who are, and that's why I brought this hadith, who are the أهل بيت Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم? Because they want to know. Since the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم told us, we also need to know. يا زيد أليس نساؤه من أهل بيته? They thought like linguistically, his wives, are his wives not from his household? قال نساؤه من أهل بيته. His wives, his women literally in Arabic, are from his bait, from his household. ولكن أهل بيته من حرم الصدقة بعده. The Prophet ﷺ, he said his the people of his household are those who are not allowed to take zakah after him. and he named them. Qala wa hum. So they don't leave the sheikh alone. They said, who are they? So sometimes you have to be like that. That's why the ulama said, there are two people who don't learn. One of them is shy. Shy. I was shy, I didn't ask. So you will become, yani you will remain not know. And the one who is arrogant. He says, oh, I don't need to know this. For example, yeah? Who learns? The one who, and sometimes the sheikh may be even annoyed with him, but his niyyah is not to annoy the sheikh. His niyyah is to learn. His intention is to learn for the sake of Allah. And the person doesn't, because sometimes all of us, we experience sometimes, when some sheikhs come, you think sometimes, that's a stupid question, I won't ask that, you know. But you shouldn't, because maybe it's not stupid. What you think is stupid question, it's not stupid. And I always remind myself and brothers, how many things were written in Islam because of questions. Sahih Muslim, from which I'm quoting, in the Muqaddimah he said, Rahmahullah, addressing, the ulama said, we don't know who he's addressing, but we can guess maybe one of the students, maybe someone else. He said, you requested me to write something about the hadith of Rasulullah, so he wrote the whole book for him. Yani this person, imagine if he didn't ask. Most books, fatawa, of course we know that fatawa, the plural of fatwa, when the people ask the alim, and he replies, and look, Aqidah Wasitiyah, very small book, Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, how much benefit it has brought. Just a person from Wasit, that's a place in Sham, he asked, they say Qadi, one of the judges, he said, please Sheikh, clarify for us the Aqidah of the people of the Sunnah. And he wrote just few notes between, they say, Asr and Maghrib. Subhanallah. Many, I even suggested to some sheikh, I said, sheikh, what do you think if some student of knowledge collected those books just for us to know, like they say, Unsul Majalis, when we sit together and say, we mention together, how many books were written as a response to a request from someone? That's the way of the ulama. Nowadays, everyone writes. Like Imam Zahabi, rahmahullah, said in Tazkiratul Huffaz, لست من أهل التصنيف وإن سودت وجهك بالمداد. Some, he said, people, I want to say to them, and I join him in that, you're not from people who should be authoring anything, even if you color your face with ink. Meaning that now everyone writes, you don't know who to read. Even those who should never write. Now, so for that reason, what the Prophet said here, they want to know. So the Sheikh said, they asked, whom? Who are they? Qala hum alu Ali. Alu Ali. The family of Ali. Radiallahu anhu. Wa alu Aqil. And al Aqil. Wa alu Ja'far. Wa alu Abbas. Those four. Them and their families, all of them who come even now. And the qala kullu ha'ula'i hurima sadaqa, they want to make sure all of these not permissible zakah. Qala na'am. That's the end of hadith. He said yes. This hadith is full of fawaid, but we don't have time to explore all of them. And the ulama, since we have some hadith in the other books of hadith, they added also Al-Harith bin Abdul Muttalib. In any case, Banu Hashim, Banu Abdul Muttalib, they said general rule. That's the Ahlul Bayt Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And what Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala mentioned in Surah Al-Ahzab, that generally concerns, that's why they said his wives. Because Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala mentioned his wives. But the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when he says, I remind you with Allah regarding the people of my household, it means what? As the Sahaba radiallahu anhum understood it, it means to give them special treatment due to them being the relatives of the Prophet ﷺ and due to them being believers. Otherwise, Abu Lahab from the family. Uncle, Abu Talib, who helped the Prophet ﷺ, and as I said to you, maybe I said, maybe not, maybe I said in other places, Abu Talib, some people say he died as a believer. And of course, we have hadith very clear in Sahih Bukhari that Abu Talib, he didn't die as a believer. And of course, those are the people who want to prove to us that every family of the Prophet, all of them, they were believers. That's not true. Because it's not us who's saying it, it's the Prophet. Like he said to that man, my father and your father in the hellfire. So some people say, how can you say this? I say, well, we did not say it. The Prophet said it. So if you have an issue, go check the hadith. Just like we say about Allah. And the Prophet said, Allah allowed me, أذن الله لي في زيارة قبر أمي. Allah allowed me to visit the grave of my mother, ولكن لم يأذن لي بالاستغفار. But he didn't allow me to ask استغفار, ask forgiveness for her from Allah. So when you say this hadith, أعوذ بالله, how can you say this? We say this because the Prophet ﷺ said it. Our deen is very easy. Know what Allah said, what Rasulullah ﷺ said, and follow it. That's it. Don't invent the wheel. It's been invented, alhamdulillah. Just apply it. It's we make a square wheel, but ours, you know. It's not correct. Leave it round, alhamdulillah. Naam? So for that reason, and this hadith, the ulama said, it's permissible to go to the grave of a non-Muslim, even a mushrik, for what reason? لِلْإِعْتِبَار. To think about death, to think about akhira, but not to ask forgiveness for them, but it's permissible for, and it's good for a Muslim to go to visit graves of his brother Muslims, to make dua for them, and to say salam to them, and to ask Allah to forgive them. And it's very good for us to do that. And I encourage everyone to do that. For those reasons, not for other reasons. Naam. Also, another point that we must know is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose those great people. And if you look at the history of the call, every call requires two things. Every effort, actually, not only religions. Every effort you want to do requires two things. In Arabic, it's easy to say because they rhyme. Mal wa rijal. They require some money, some expenditure. And they require rijal. Men, meaning men and women, meaning staff, people, resources. Whether they're human resources or financial resources. For that reason, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose for him the best of those who had the cleanest hearts, as Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu said, that those were special people. Allah chose them to accompany His Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And they used to obey the Prophet alayhi salam. And like I said, because this topic is following from last week, to really love the Prophet alayhi salam is to obey and to do what he says. If you come to your teacher or professor at university or your teacher anywhere and you say, teacher, I love you, but everything you say is rubbish. Sorry, you know, but I love you. So he says, what are you talking about? I taught you so much. No, you know, with respect, but no respect, you know, and things like that. So no one will consider that to be love. If someone says it, or someone says to his father or mother, you know, mother or father, I love you, but I can't do anything good for you. And no one in his right mind says that. For that reason, those who say to follow the Prophet ﷺ is to go against what he said, they don't say it, but they do it, they contradict even logic, human logic. Before we go to Quran and Sunnah. For that reason, the Sahaba radiallahu anhu, we have to think why Allah raised them, brothers and sisters, because Allah doesn't raise people for no reason. And He doesn't humiliate people for no reason. They did something and said something, but mainly did, because saying is easy. They did so much for Islam and for Allah and for the Prophet ﷺ that Allah raised them, and he, some of them named by name. When the Prophet ﷺ said to Ubay ibn Ka'b from the Ansar, he said, Ya Ubay, Allah said to me, listen Quran from Ubay. He said, he was shocked. He said, Allah said my name? He said, yes. And he started crying. Of course, they know Allah said, otherwise how the Prophet know? Like when we ask someone, say, you know, he said by name to say to yourself, he said by name. And of course, Zayd bin Haritha mentioned Zayd in Surah Al-Ahzab. فَإِذَا قَدَى زَيْدٌ مِّنْهَا وَطَرًا زَوَّجْنَاكَهَا وَلَمَّا عَفْوًا وَلَمَّا نَعَمْ نَعَمْ. So Zayd is mentioned, I don't remember the ayah very well, but I remember that Zayd is mentioned in those ayat. And also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned them by wasf, like Muhajirun Ansar, in a few places in the Quran. Muhajirun, as we know, those who did hijrah for Allah, for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he mentioned that. Ansar, as you know from the word Ansar, the helpers, those who helped them. For that reason, it is not possible to spread anything except through true people who recognize the worth of the call and they follow it and they are prepared to sacrifice for it. Just like now, we say, Ikhwan, we need to do a lecture. If there is no one prepared to sacrifice, we can't do it. Something has to be sacrificed. We either have to pay brothers to help us, or those brothers and sisters, they have to sacrifice time, effort, whatever else, to help us. For that reason, the more we sacrifice for Allah, the more He gives us. And that's what the Sahaba radiallahu anhum did. And those who were closest to the Prophet sallam, they embraced Islam from the first, like Khadija radiallahu anha, Ali radiallahu anhu, who was the cousin of the Prophet sallam, and Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu. And of course, the ulama differed who from those three embraced Islam first. So some ulama gave a clever solution. They said, from women, Khadija. From men, Abu Bakr. And from young people, Ali. So we don't have a problem. So those, imagine someone comes and says, I'm a prophet, Allah said, and see, I saw this angel squeeze me. And like we said when I was doing the khutbah last week, the Prophet came shaking. Even though he knew it is possible to happen, but he didn't expect it. And he said, لَقَدْ خَشِيتُ عَلَى نَفْسِي. I was worried about myself. And Khadija radiallahu anha and Aisha is the one narrating this hadith. This the ulama called from Marasilu Sahaba. Aisha, she didn't witness that. But Marasilu Sahaba, something they didn't witness, they are still authentic because they heard from another Sahabi. And all Sahaba we call in the hadith literature udul, which means they don't require any scholar to see Abdullah bin Mas'ud. Let's check, is he a good narrator? Because Allah did for them tazkiyah. No one needs to come and check any of the Sahaba. For that reason, even if Aisha says, or Ibn Abbas, or Ibn Umar, or those who were young, they say Khadija or someone, we believe them. If to them, the chain is authentic. Aisha narrated that hadith, and Khadija supported and took the Prophet ﷺ to her cousin Waraqa bin Nawfal, and Waraqa supported him and said, your people will drive you out. And the Prophet said, "Wa mukhrijiyahum, will they drive me out?" He said, "No one came with what you came, except they drove them out." No surprise when we try to practice the Sunnah. Some people say this, some families say this. You have to be patient. What do you think? It's bed of roses. At the beginning, Allah wants to see you really what you say, or not. For that reason, Khadija radiallahu anha supported him. And she said things that show her knowledge and understanding. She said, Allah will never humiliate you because you look after your guests, you look after poor people, you look after your relatives, you help people stricken in need. Wa alaykum salam wa rahmatullah. She said those things, and you know, moral support is more important than financial. Someone can give you money and he doesn't care. But someone says those things that will stay for you forever, will stay with you forever. That is why the Sahaba, they have that great status. And the Ahlul Bayt from the Sahaba, including Ali radiallahu anhu. But there are some Sahaba who came after As-Sabiqun Al-Awwalun. Or they were not, let's say, the very first to embrace Islam. But they occupied, they maybe, you can say, got promoted quicker than others. Like Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. He was number 40 or 50 from the people who became Muslim. But due to how much he sacrificed, how much he did, how much he protected the da'wah of Islam, he rose to number 2. He wasn't number 2. What did he do to the point that the Prophet ﷺ said, when Umar walks one side, shaitan runs away. We can't get rid of shaitan. But I want to remind also everyone, you know, many people, they like Umar, they say, mashallah. I know many brothers who come from my country, from Albania, from Pakistan, they say, Umar, mashallah. I say to them, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu is more mashallah. Why? Because he is higher than him. Even though you think Umar is mashallah. Because they say Umar, he used to, if he sees something straight away and he doesn't mess around. Because some brothers like it, including me. But we have to know Islamically, I think most brothers like it. That's how men are, you know. But Islamically, we have to know that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he's higher than Umar. And he's more knowledgeable than Umar. And he's more understanding than Umar radiallahu anhum. But the issue of Umar bin al-Khattab, I brought up radiallahu anhu, because to show that sometimes you may be behind in something, but you can do other things for Allah and become closer to Allah. And of course, some of the ayat they mention, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah At-Tawbah, verse 100, As-sabiquna al-awwaluna min al-muhajirin wal-ansar wal-ladhina attaba'uhum bi-ihsan. So Allah divided people three parts. The muhajirun, those who did hijrah, the ansar, those who helped them. And third, because we cannot be muhajirin or ansar, we were not born at that time. Some brothers say, I wish I was born that time. You shouldn't wish, because Allah made you to live this time. And you don't know, that time you could be fighting the Prophet ﷺ. How do you know, guarantee that you will be one of his followers? Iyadhan billah. Meaning, Iyadhan billah, to fight the Prophet ﷺ. So, he said the third group, وَالَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوهُمْ بِإِحْسَانِ. Those who follow them with ihsan, not just follow. There are many people who say, we follow Sahaba. But correctly, with ihsan. Radiyallahu anhum wa radu anhu. Allah is pleased with them, including if we follow the Muhajirin Ansar. And they are pleased with him. They will be. Wa a'adda lahum jannatin tajri tahtaha al-anhar. And he has prepared for them jannat, gardens. Jannah in Arabic means garden. Thick garden, full of vegetation, full of trees. But that's why it shares the same root as Jinnah and Junnah. That they call in Arabic Tathleeth or Muthallath. Junnah, Jinnah, Jannah. All different words, the same root. But they all mean istitar, beyond which you can't see. Jannah, so thick with vegetation and trees, you can't see behind that. And he has prepared for them such gardens, underneath which rivers flow. If someone said, do you prefer a house here in the main street, or there is one, there is a nice river, and trees and same price. Say, go for the river. No argument. No discussion. Go for the river. Every time I open the door, mashallah, is a river, is tree. Even though the tree is nothing, it's just one tree. You know some people. So that in the dunya only. Jannat in the Jannah, where the small piece of salt of the whip is better than the whole dunya. And what it has? Jannat tajri tahta al-anhar. Khalidina fiha abada. Staying there forever. Thalika al-fawz al-azim. That is the great achievement. That is the great success. So if someone wants to be successful, he must be from that third group. Those who follow Sahaba, Muhajirin and Ansar, in the correct way. For that, we need all to get ilm, to get knowledge, what they used to do, how they used to understand. Naam. Also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, some of the ayat, there are many, many places, more than 30 or more, where he praised the Sahaba. Naam. لا يستوي منكم من أنفق من قبل الفتح وقاتل. Those who spent before the Fath, either Fath of Hudaybiyah, some ulama said, or Fath of Mecca, وقاتل and fought, they are not equal. أولئك أعظم درجة من الذين أنفقوا من بعد وقاتلوا. They are greater in degree than those who spent after and they fought. وَكُلًّا وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الْحُسْنَى. And both parties, Allah has promised husna, great reward or jannah. وَاللَّهُ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ خَبِيرٌ. In Surah Al-Hadid, of course. And also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in many other places the sacrifice that the Sahaba did from the Muhajirin and the Ansar. And just to show you one of the great sacrifices, and I think before, when we had a talk on Sahaba, I think in this same masjid, I may have mentioned it, but I want to remind, because it's a great story. Mus'ab bin Umair, radiallahu anhu, was one of the people who was one of the, was brought up in one of the richest families in Mecca. And when he believed in the Prophet and followed him, his family took everything he had from him, and he became extremely poor due to that, and he died in the battle of Uhud, and they couldn't find enough cloth to cover his whole body. They said, when we used to cover the face, the feet became visible. When we cover the feet, the face became visible. Ikhwan, subhanallah, how much yaqeen you must have, how much you must be convinced and attach your heart to Akhirah, so that none of this matters. If I believe and I follow and I truly believe that even if I die, like I said to you, in the grave, the angels from Jannah will come straight away. And they will wrap you in the kafan of Jannah, the shroud of Jannah. And they will bring the hanut of Jannah, the smell and the fragrance of Jannah, straight away. And the hadith of Bara ibn Azib is very clear. It says, لَمْ يَدَعُوا بِيَدِهِ أَيْ مَلِكَ الْمَوْتِ طَرْفَةَ عَيْنِ. When the angel of death takes the soul of the believer, the malaika from Jannah, they're waiting. They don't leave the soul in the hands of the angel of death for one eye blink. طَرْفَةَ عَيْنِ. They take him and they ascend, and they have that shroud from Jannah, not from dunya. All of that the Sahaba know. For them, do you take my wealth? Okay, no problem. I don't leave my religion because I am convinced that this is the religion of truth and it's just a trial. Even if I die, it's no problem because that is what's waiting for me. That's why when your relatives die who are good Muslims, don't be sad because they are in a better life than us. Wallahi, they are. We believe the words of the Prophet ﷺ. So Mus'ab bin Umair, they couldn't find. So the Prophet ﷺ said, at the suggestion of some Sahaba, cover the face and the feet with grass. And Abd al-Rahman bin Auf radiallahu anhu, who became so rich that they used to say half of Medina used to owe him money. He used, after the death of the Prophet ﷺ, he used to fast and do ibadah and do things. And once they brought him iftar. And Imam al-Bukhari, as far as I remember, mentioned it in his Sahih. And he said he started crying and he didn't touch any of the food. They said, why are you crying? He said, I remembered Mus'ab bin Umair. Because he said, I fear that our ajr has been given to us in this dunya. Look how Sahaba think, subhanallah. Our problem is not ability, it's attitude, how we think. The Sahaba, they think, radiallahu anhum, look how much they've done for Allah. They still think, you know, we fear the ajr of the hereafter is been brought here because of those wealth and riches that Allah gave us. Because all of that is a trial. And he said, I remembered because I believe he was better than me. Or something along those lines. Yani Mus'ab bin Umair was better than him. And this I'm saying not just to make someone laugh or cry, as they say nowadays, you can't become a good speaker unless you make someone laugh or cry. I'm not saying it for that. I'm saying it for us to think that when you know these things, those sacrifices become easy. Easy, because for some people who, you know, they think this is it. Like someone told me a story of that man who lost some billions in the financial crisis and he committed suicide. Why? Because that's what he knows. Even though he had some millions and billions left. But a Muslim, when he knows that everything, if the people were to ask from the beginning till end of creation, from jinn and humans, imagine how much we will ask. And that doesn't decrease from Allah's wealth and possession and kingdom, except how you put, imagine in front of a sea, an ocean, you put a needle in it, and what? How much comes? That's the greatness of Allah. That's why we must think about what made the Sahaba radiallahu anhum believe to that extent, sacrifice to that extent, because they knew three things. They're very simple, but they're not simple at the same time. They knew Allah. They knew what Allah has prepared for them. From good and bad. If you're good, this. If you're bad, that. They knew Rasulullah SAW. That's why they used to fight for his hair. Because barakah you can only seek from the Prophet SAW. Not from sheikhs now. They used to want to be with him. Abu Huraira used to be so hungry, he used to be on the ground. How many of us have ever been on the ground because of hunger? Our lunch is 1/2 hour late. We're saying to the wife, what's going on? And we said 12 o'clock. This, I'm talking about myself. So my wife said, just keep quiet. He said, subhanallah, every time you do this to me. No? 1/2 hour late. Abu Huraira is on the ground. And he says, he only accompanied the Prophet ﷺ 3 years or around 3 years. And he became most knowledgeable in hadith. Most. That's why some people hate Abu Huraira. They even spread news, Abu Huraira never existed. Why? Because if you remove hadith of Abu Huraira from the equation, most of the deen is gone. A lot of the deen is gone. They say, I even read it somewhere or something. Abu Huraira never existed. Of course, that's a lie. So, those people, they sacrificed. The difference between us and them is the thinking. And of course, other examples of their great sacrifice and the belief that they had that made them sacrifice, because Iman, if you don't have true belief and you don't believe and you have doubts, that will always be noted in your actions, that they will not be the same. And another example I want to give, Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari, which the ulama of hadith give especially. He was old at the time, and he heard a hadith from one of the Sahaba, or rather from one person who heard a Sahabi. He said to me that the Prophet ﷺ said this, on the Day of Judgment, the people will be brought forth, resurrected, hufatan, uratan, ghurlan, ay ghir makhtunin. Hufat, barefooted, urat, not naked, no clothes, ghurlan, without circumcision. Aisha said, Ya Rasulullah, how men and women naked? The Prophet ﷺ said that they will be much more grave and important than them looking at each other. They will forget that. That's the hadith. And the person narrated to Jabir ibn Abdullah is reliable. He's not a liar. So some of us would say, Alhamdulillah, that's great. Jabir ibn Abdullah buys a riding animal, rides to Egypt 1 month for one hadith. 1 month. And he knocks on the door. The man comes out and he says, did you hear this from the Prophet ﷺ? He said, yes. And he told him, that's how I heard. He said, Jazakallah khair. He goes back. He said, where are you going? Stay some time. He said, no, that's why I came. I didn't come for food. Another month back. Nowadays, if you say, I always say, if you go please to Glasgow, get a book of hadith for me, they'll say, you crazy. Book of hadith, that's why you're sending me to Glasgow or whatever else you want to go. He tell me something else, I can go, meaning for the dunya. Go bring me £1,000, no problem, I'll give you 10%. Now that is the difference. That's why they became great, because for them the dunya became as the Prophet ﷺ told them. The dunya is a way, this world is a way to please Allah. Not a way to become slave to it. They used to have Anas bin Malik radiallahu anhu. The Prophet ﷺ made dua for him to have barakah in his wealth and children. They say that he was the only person in around Medina whose gardens used to give yield twice a year. Twice a year. And he asked one of his daughters, how many children do we have? She said, more than 100. And all of that because of the dua of Rasulullah. And he used to, if he misses Salatul Eid with the Muslims, he used to get all his children, the massive jama'ah, and all his servants and everyone in his palace, qasr, and do Salatul Eid. Of course, if you have jama'ah, 200 people, that's like Eid, almost. So that happened, and even Abu Huraira, who used to lie on the ground, and he used to be so hungry, that he used to ask Abu Bakr, Abu Bakr, please read some Quran. And he said, I don't want Quran, I want him to take me to feed me. Oh, Umar, please read Quran. And he passes. Then the Prophet, before I say, he knew what I want. He said, come with me. And the Prophet took him to his houses. Nine. Nothing. You have anything? No. You have anything? No. One of them said, we have some milk that was given to us as a gift. Milk? Pint of milk? 2 pints. Now if someone gives us milk, we say, it's crazy. You know? That neighbor is crazy. He gave us milk. Allah yahdi him, you know. May Allah guide them. Next time, maybe give us some biryani or something. And the Prophet ﷺ, he used to say, لَوْ أُهْدِيَ إِلَيَّ كُرَاعَ لَقَبِلْتْ. If someone gave me as a gift Qura'a. Qura'a is foot of the sheep. Foot which they sell a few pence, you know. Gift, 1 foot. He said, I would have accepted it. And if I were called to eat it, I would have answered it. Nowadays, if we don't have lamb shoulder, we don't go. Sometimes, I'm exaggerating, of course. So, the point I'm making is that these people were, in their attitude, they were great. And of course, how much the Ahlul Bayt, they helped the Prophet ﷺ, Ja'far radiallahu anhu, Hamza radiallahu anhu. Hamza, of course, the Prophet ﷺ called him Sayyidu Shuhada, the leader of the Shuhada, the leader of the martyrs, the Shuhada. And even Wahshi, who killed Hamza in battle, who became later a Muslim, in Sahih al-Bukhari, when he came and he was a Muslim, the Prophet said, go away from me. He's a Muslim. Did Allah forgive him that sin or not? That's a big sin, to kill Hamza radiallahu anhu. But subhanAllah, Allah has amazing ways. He guided that man. That's why the Prophet said, Allah laughs at two men. One of them kills the other, both enter Jannah. Just that example. One of them kills in battle, the Muslim fight non-Muslim, the non-Muslim kills him. So that becomes, if his intention of course right, shaheed. The other Allah guides, both enter Jannah. That example. So for that reason, those great people, they were great, not because they used to talk. Because nowadays, they used to talk little. You just analyze, you read books of history. Their talk is little and to the point. Like Allah said, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, qulu qawlan sadida. Say to the point, don't talk too much. We have now, sometimes we come to gatherings. Yani some gatherings, someone doesn't let you talk. All gatherings, you're sitting 2 hours just listening to him. I say to some brothers, if that brother is coming, I'm not coming. Yahi, I don't have time 2 hours to listen to his lecture. And if there was fa'ida, I don't remember it. If there is any benefit, there is no benefit. Just some news, this. And if you try to say something, he interrupts. I mean, interrupts because he's already talking. But you try to talk? No, no way. What's the point of me coming? Now, so for that reason, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they were little talking. They just didn't used to talk too much, but they used to do. Look how they used to learn the Quran. All of us know, but very few maybe practice. 10 ayat they read, they learn what to do. Then they memorize. They learn, they do. Then again, 10 ayat. Then again, then again. They say Ibn Umar took 8 years to memorize Baqarah. Now, if 8 years, the whole Quran, we say, remove my kid from there. This madrasa is rubbish. They don't teach anything. 8 years Quran, what's this? We want 8 years, 3 Quran, quick. Does he understand? Who cares? That's how some, I saw with my own eyes, some people bring children to the madrasa, they don't pray. Shocking. Shocking. They said some, they launched a Barbie doll. You know Barbie doll? With hijab. They launched somewhere in Malaysia or something, I don't know. Or Indonesia. So they're showing, they said, I didn't see some brothers saying, someone buying for her daughter. She doesn't have hijab, the woman. She bought Barbie doll with hijab. They said, why did you buy it? She said, so my daughter can learn hijab. MashaAllah. And you, don't you need to learn hijab? You need the Barbie doll as well. But big one maybe. What is better for your daughter, to learn from mother or to learn from the doll? What's better for the son, to learn from the father or from something? That's how the Sahaba, that's why no surprise that their children became ulama, many of them. Their children became very good people. Look at the children of Abu Bakr. 4 generations Sahaba. 4. The only family. four generations. His father, himself, his children, his grandchildren. The only family. Look at Abdullah bin Umar. He's 13. He wants to take part in battle of Uhud. 13. Look at Abdullah bin Abbas. Yan, the Prophet 12 or something, he's teaching him, Ya Ghulam, Inni U'allimuka Kalimat. And he teaches him one of the most important hadith in Islam. Ihfadh Allah yahfadhuk. I will teach you some words of wisdom. Protect Allah and He will protect you. Meaning protect the deen of Allah. And then the hadith goes on and on and on for rububiyyah and qadr and... So we need to teach our children from an early age, and we need to have that environment where they feel that we are not oppressing them, but we are teaching them nice things. So if you say, switch off the TV, because it's showing rubbish, sorry to say, that's how I say to my kids. What's this on TV? I have 3 TVs at home. Not like those who say, A'udhu Billah, TV is not allowed, and he has 5 TVs. I'm saying that because some brothers told me. Some person attacked me personally when I was doing a lecture. And he said, A'udhu Billah, you allow TV? I said, with those conditions, shurut, not everything. And he said, no. And then brother said, he has a few TVs in his house. I said, Yahi, why did he give me hard time then? You should have told me before. So, but... No channels. I'm saying this to show that we must be careful. And what I said in some of the khutbas, the sisters must listen to your husband. If he's telling you, you shouldn't watch this. You know, sisters like watching all these soaps and things like that. It's no good. What's the good about it? Yes, I went bought milk from the corner shop. MashaAllah. That's amazing. Then I met the neighbor. Wow. Oh yeah, the other neighbor got married. SubhanAllah. And we're watching. There's nothing else to do. Yani, what is this? We're wasting our time on neighbors. We have neighbors. We haven't seen them for ages. The only neighbors we see is the TV neighbors. What is this? I believe that watching soaps is a sign of degradation, mental degradation. Wallahi. For anyone, whether it is a man or woman, doesn't matter. Why? Because it means you have nothing to do. Just that. And that makes you remove your intellect. I'm not saying reduce. Remove. Totally. And the stories they tell, you feel nasty to hear even. Alhamdulillah, I don't watch. But some people tell me, oh, someone did that, and someone said that, And for that reason, we have to start with ourselves to build a house that's like the Sahaba radiallahu anhu. Because they achieved what they achieved, not because they used to talk too much. And even then, subhanallah, they used to say about, do you think this man is good? They say, until he goes into his house, he follows the sunnah, subhanallah. Meaning we don't know what he does inside. That's how they are meticulous. They don't want to say something they don't know about this man. Not like now, 15 titles or 15 abuse. You have to be in the middle. Say what you know about your brother. That's why the Prophet said, if you think someone is good, say, نَحْسِبُهُ كَذَلِكَ. We think he's like that. And Allah knows. So for that reason, I want to summarize. Why did they, before we summarize, I want to say something, 2 points. First, to love Sahaba, to do taraddi, meaning radiallahu anhum, may Allah be pleased with them, to do tarahum, may Allah have rahmah on them, is sign of Ahlul Sunnah. And to hate them, or some of them, is one of the signs of people of bid'ah. That includes Ahlul Bayt. So in relation to the family of the Prophet ﷺ, we don't hate, iyadha billah, but we don't go overboard as some people do. We don't exceed the limits set by Allah. to the extent that they say Abu Bakr and Umar and everyone is nothing, just Ali. That is incorrect. We say like the Sahaba, like the Prophet, he made pray who, when he was alive, who led Salah? Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. Not Ali. For that reason, the ulama said, who says Ali is better than Uthman, yet we don't say he's an innovator, even though it's not correct. Because Uthman is better than Ali. The Sahaba agreed on that. Who says Ali was more deserving of the Khilafah, of the rule, than Uthman, then he enters a dangerous territory of being an innovator, iyadan billah. Why? Because he goes against the opinion of all Sahaba. They accepted it, including Ali. He gave bay'ah to Abu Bakr. He pledged allegiance to him. Yes, after a while, but he did. And for the rest, I refer to history. With also from the adab, from our manners with the Sahaba, radiallahu anhum, to talk about the good and the great what they have done, and to keep quiet about mistakes they made, especially what the ulama said, sukut amma shajara baynahum, min khilafin wa qital. Some of them fought between themselves. They had some differences that we don't explore, not because we don't want to say, but we don't want people who don't understand to start hating some Sahaba. Because as Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah said, and others and ulama of Sunnah, they say, those Sahaba are between two people. And that's what we say about ulama as well. Mujtahid, they were all mujtahid. They used their judgment. Mujtahid has either one reward, because he wanted to reach the Sunnah, but he didn't reach it. So he gets one reward, ajr. And the second who reaches the correct way and the correct path, gets two rewards for his effort and for being right. That's the Sahaba and that's the ulama. So they either have one ajr, إذا أخطأ فله أجر وإن أصاب فله أجران. That's it. That's very easy. And it's not allowed to talk bad about Muawiyah radiallahu anhu because he fought Ali. And it's not allowed to talk bad about any of the Sahaba. And some of the ulama of our time, he authored a book, Jazahullah Khaira, entitled Man Sabba As-Sahaba wa Muawiyah fa Ummuhu Hawiyah. Who abuses Sahaba and Muawiyah, then his destination and his mother is Hawiyah, hellfire. That is the belief of Ahlul Sunnah. We're not allowed to abuse any of the Sahaba. And finally, I want to summarize by saying, what is that they did that made them who they were and who they became, to the extent that the Prophet ﷺ said, do not abuse my Sahaba. And this hadith is in Bukhari and Muslim. لو أنفق أحدكم مثل أحد ذهب, أي جبل أحد. If one of you were to spend like mountain of Uhud, not this masjid, mountain of Uhud, in gold, ما بلغ مد أحدهم أو نصيفه, it wouldn't reach mud. Mud is like what you take like this, mud. They say half a liter or something. Mud. The Prophet ﷺ used to do wudu with mud, half a liter water. Not like now, Niagara Falls. After he leaves, 5 minutes. Oh, sorry. When they go to wudu, until he leaves. You think, subhanAllah, it's Niagara Falls. He's going to wash the whole masjid. No one cares. The Prophet said, if you spend like Uhud in gold, it won't reach like this of them. Why? Why? Yani we have gold, they have gold. Why? We have to think about this hadith. We have to ask why? Why wouldn't reach? Many things. One of them is here. Something you can't reach. But we try. And they said Abu Bakr and others, they didn't become better by doing more salah than others. They used to do a lot of salah. Together they used to do salah, they used to do salah. But with something, بشيء وقر في القلب. Something they had in the heart. The conviction, the ambition, the how they used to love Allah and humble themselves to Him. For that reason, there are four things they achieved it through. And they are mentioned in Surah Al-Asr. That's why for Maw'idha, Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah said, if that surah was only revealed for reminder, not for ahkam, it would have been enough for us. And that's iman, correct belief. And ilm is included in this, knowledge. How much they sacrificed just to get to the Prophet ﷺ, some of them. Read the story of Salman radiallahu anhu. It's a beautiful story. And it's a great story. Some of them, they used to endure beatings, torture, just to get to the Prophet ﷺ. Secondly, to back that up with actions. What the Prophet ﷺ said, they used to do. Do, they do. They don't say, is it mustahab, wajib? They don't ask that. The same hadith of Abu Huraira. The Prophet ﷺ brought him, said, some milk we have from one of the houses. He didn't say, drink, Abu Huraira, straight away. You hungry, drink. He said, go bring your companions, those poor people from Ahlus Sufa in the masjid. So the Prophet says, no, Abu Huraira is walking. In the hadith, in Sahih Muslim, and saying, I thought to myself, they're going to drink all of the milk. Because it's just little and there, 20, 30 people, all hungry like me. One of them can drink it. But he said another thing which is amazing, which is, ولكن ما كان من طاعة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بد. But there was no way I could disobey the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. The man is dying of hunger really. He's lying on the ground. And he's saying, yet I will bring them because I know that he will not order me bad. That's the belief. So he brought, and the Prophet didn't start with him. Subhanallah. He said, look, not the Prophet didn't give the Sahaba. He said, Ya Abahir, give them. Look, Abu Hurairah is taking the milk in front of him. Subhanallah. Nice cold milk. And give everyone, and they drink and drink and drink. Imagine what's going through him. And until everyone was full, then the Prophet smiled and said, Ishrabi Abahir. Drink Abu Huraira. And all of that he's doing. Now if one alim says to us, Yahi, you're hungry, go bring the brothers. Sheikh, wallahi, I don't have time for this. I have to go get some takeaway, you know. So he drinks. Then he said, drink. He drank. Then third time drink, he said, until he said, Ma ajidu lahu maslakan. I don't have any room left. He said, then that's fine. So that's the application of that ilm. It's not enough to know. Some many people, when you say, they say, we know, akhi. It's not enough to know. Iblis knows. Shaitan knows. But he doesn't do. So that's the second point. To do. And the third is to call to that knowledge. To call others. And also to advise our brothers and sisters between sisters. That is the da'wah. That is the real perseverance and patience. And fourthly, very important, to have sabr on that. Look, if Abu Huraira and others, they don't have sabr, nothing, they won't. If they don't have patience, they don't have perseverance for Allah, not for anything else, for the sake of Allah. And to make you know how much you can bear, and you don't know how much you can bear. So the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they constantly extended that, how much they could bear, for the sake of Allah. Those four things made them what they were. To believe and have knowledge, that's very important. and to act upon that knowledge and belief, to call others and to be patient on that until you meet Allah. That's how they did. And Allah said, رضي الله عنه مرضوا عنه. Allah is pleased with them, will be, and they will be pleased with him. And he, as I said, included a third group. And we, inshallah, hope to be from them, those who followed them in the correct way. Na'am, so I stop here. May Allah have rahmah and pleasure upon the Sahaba and Ahlul Bayt, and enable us to follow them correctly and join us with them in Jannah.